Scientific illustration is artwork depicting scientific subject matter, and this can be medical, this can be biological, zoological, everything within the biomedical domain. So scientific illustrators actually are communicators. We and our students have to depict what's in the head of the scientist, and the science has to be conveyed in the best possible way for a specific target audience. So this can be for patients, and it's called patient education, but it can also be for museums or for scientific journals. So everywhere where there is science, we need people to depict it and to share it with other people.
Especially anatomy is a science closely connected to visual arts. It traditionally was. And certainly in the time of Leonardo da Vinci and Vesalius, there was a very close connection between visual art and science, certainly the anatomical science. And Professor Drucker and some other people wanted to re-establish that against the trend of the time. Nowadays, it's already more accepted that art and science go together, but in the 1980s, 90s, it was quite exclusive to connect that.
In Europe, there has been a long tradition in scientific illustration. We all know Leonardo da Vinci, and people like to think of him as one of the first scientific illustrators. But actually, if you look at it from the point of view I was just explaining, the definition of a scientific illustrator, then he wasn't communicating his artwork, because his findings were kept in his codexes, where he drew all his anatomical findings, but was not shared until it was found in the 18th century. Another person, Andreas Vesalius, however, was somebody who we like to look at as the father of the modern anatomy. And his findings were illustrated by Johannes van Kalkar. And together they made a book, and it was published in Switzerland with beautiful woodcuts. And this was actually the first scientific anatomical publication. You could say the first PubMed, what we have nowadays, where people share their knowledge. And now people could react on it, people could study it, and that's why you need scientific illustrators. You need to be able to communicate that with people.
Master-apprentice tradition was already present in the Middle Ages and in the Renaissance, and certainly in the 17th century. So if you look to the studio of Rubens or Rembrandt or people like that, they had some apprentices, mostly a lot of them, and the work was shared. So an apprentice started early with very simple actions and then gradually became a master himself and did larger parts of the work. And we tried to model our course more or less after the same model. We call it atelier model. So the Italians call it bottega model. So like a workshop where experienced and less experienced people worked together as colleagues. And we had the possibility to do that because the Academy of Arts had a more or less similar tradition. And the Maastricht University Faculty of Medicine has a teaching program that's also problem-based, so more based on discussing casus than simply learning theoretical questions.
In the world, there are 5 courses in scientific illustration on this level, master courses in scientific illustration or medical illustration. 4 of them are in the United States and in Canada. And this is actually the only one of its kind in Europe. And I think what makes the Maastricht course unique is the way we approach our students. It's according to the what we call the atelier model, or the studio model, in which people work on their assignments, and while working have to study themselves and also ask questions. There's a teacher around every day, and also they share their knowledge. It's a learning community. The program is built up in 3 teams: animal, man, and surgery. And within every teams, the student have to carry out 5 or 6 assignments. Those assignments are carried out in traditional techniques in the beginning, but to be able to gather the information, to gather the facts that need to be depicted, they sometimes have to do dissections. So our students also dissect both animals and human dissections. Of course, we follow anatomy classes. And then there's surgery. So our students go into the surgical theater to witness the procedure there. And then they have to depict the surgery into specific steps for patient education or for scientific case reports. People from all kinds of backgrounds apply for this program. We get people from the scientific direction, the scientific domains like medicine or biology, but we get also people from the artistic side, so academies of fine art. And the nice thing about it is that they can influence each other within this atelier model.
And we try to do it on an equal level. Only one person, the teacher, is slightly more experienced than the student, and at a certain level you reach the same level at a certain moment. And Leonardo da Vinci already said it's a bad teacher that doesn't educate pupils that are better than him, finally. So.